Now, I watched a documentary on oceanography last night, so I'm going to give you an aquatic analogy, a little obtuse. So there are websites and then there are websites. The first kind are large. They are like whales and sharks in this large ocean of the web, right? They have the kind of numbers that excite advertisers. But we are really here to discuss the second kind of website. Now, these are the smaller fish in this huge ocean of the web. They do have a very clear sense of purpose and direction, and they boast that all their visitors have this one common interest. It ties them together. But they stand the daily risk of being gobbled up by these big whales and sharks. How do they prevent that from happening and survive? They can do that if they can convince advertisers to pay them a premium for the specialized audience that they bring to the table. Question really is, can they, right? So I'd like to quickly ask each one of you that we're here to discuss the challenge and promise. Raise your hand if you think the challenges really outweigh the promise of specialized or niche websites.
Hi, Shri.
The promise, yeah, hi.
Hi. So firstly, you said a fish in the ocean kind of analogy.
Yes.
Well, let me say money control at least is not a fish in the ocean. We kind of the leaders in the financial space.
Yeah, well,
that's
it's
a
about dominating
like.
Your niche, yeah.
Okay, but niche in a sense that we are, you know, finance focused and business and economy focused. Well, the challenges are, is the advertiser paying is a premium. Well, I think there is a certain premium that comes, mm-hmm. but one cannot say it's a multiple of, let's say, a generic news site. If it's 100 rupees CPM, we would get, what, 2x, 3x? Well, that's not the case. The case is, you know, a 20-30% margin, yes, because I've been on the other side of the business as well, and I've seen the premiums that publishers get. So there is a little bit of premium, yes, but the challenge is, you know, plain Jane advertising is not working. Mm-hmm. You've got to back it with intelligence and data analytics to show the value of your audiences.
Okay.
So that's the story one has to build.
Okay, all right, yeah.
Yeah, so I kind of support what you just said, that it's wrong to make that analogy. On my sites, I get 10 million video, you know, unique visitors every month.
Right.
I reach out to 40 million people through social media.
Right.
And these numbers are actually larger than a lot of TV channels themselves. So I think it's wrong to make that analogy.
Okay.
That's the first point. Second point is, talking about premiums, I'd be happy to get advertising money, forget premiums.
Mm-hmm.
And I think, and that's where the struggle lies.
Okay.
That because, and I'm going to make some controversial statements here.
Yeah.
Number one is because advertisers, media agencies, and ad agencies are still owned or run by people of my generation or one generation older, they still park 90% of their funds with traditional media, right? And simply because they've grown up in that media and they're more comfortable. One would like to ask them, where do you ask for unique deliveries, CTRs, viewability, completed views, conversion rates from the media on which you're spending 90% of your funds? There the money just goes with good hope and some guesstimates by some agencies. Whereas we as digital publishers who get the smallest fraction of their media budget are the most scrutinized and bashed up. Just because I have the data and I can be measured, rather than empower me because I have the data and give me more funds, they squeeze me out.
Okay.
So I think that as long as advertisers and media planners, and many of whom are sitting here, continue to have this schizophrenic existence, or rather, as you told me, dissociative personality disorder, the digital publishers will suffer.
Yeah.
And I think we need to wake up to that fact.
Okay, no, I'm glad you mentioned that. Now, Gopa, you have to jump in here, you know.
Yeah, so I think only person from the agency, and I can actually come back. Basically, again, I am all for it with regards to what you say, that we get scrutinized for that 10% of whatever that spends are. But that's the beauty of the medium as well. While we may continue to question in terms of we are being abused with regards to numbers, but the beauty of that medium is that we are able to actually give that data. My bigger question with the overall thing is that what do you constitute as premium? Because premium can be defined as anything as well. So if publishers can define premium for us or for brands. I think brands are more than willing to actually pump in or give premium or monies with regards to that.
Yeah. Yeah.
That's not true. That's not true, Gopa. Today, my business or my, I won't get, I'm not trying to propagate my brand, so I will not mention it. My brands are largely urban, young, adult males. We have 8 million video views, right? That should attract an Axe or a Levi's or any other, or a Fog or any other male-oriented product to jump at us, but they don't. Why? Because we are technical media site. And as if advertising on National Geographic where they show animals is more appropriate audience than my site where I am talking about gadgets. And 8 million video views should be attractive to anyone. But I don't get a single penny if I get premium.
Priyadarshi, why don't you jump in? Because I do happen to know that you describe yourself as a hardcore empiricist. So you must jump in right now.
Right. So I think just a little bit of takeaway from whatever we are discussing here. Any Game of Thrones fans? Yeah. Of course. So, you know, the way we perceive our medium or our platform, right. And I'm actually going to flip over to the other side and probably discuss the challenge first. Because we faced it ourselves and there's a perception issue somewhere. You know, the content that we create, or as you said, sir, that the audiences that you have and the 8 million video views, the great stuff which, you know, which everybody likes and everybody wants to see, is like Jon Snow, right? He's, I mean, we all believe content is king and he's the king in the north and everybody wants him to become king. Everybody likes him. He's good to look at. But the problem is that marketeers right now want somebody like a Cersei Lannister. By hook and by crook, just get the job done. She's the only one who's meeting her objectives, and that's where performance comes into play.
But can they measure this performance? Do they know they're getting that person? They don't. At least in my case, they know they're getting Jon Snow. In the other case, they have no clue what they're getting. They're just hoping like mad that they do.
So I think we need somebody like Daenerys Targaryen, who's probably in the middle, which actually is a good mix of content and performance.
Yeah.
Gopa, you had a point.
Interesting, 22 hours ago, this news that got published about iProspect launching intelligent content, I think is perfect. And so I want to understand how, where we kind of play an important role in some kind, such kind of a product, because innovation is something which still, the ownership of innovation still lies with media agencies. And the ownership of content or creating good content lies with publishers. If we can marry them together, then that'll be perfect.
So again, I agree on all of your statement. The bigger point that I think would want to make is that when you say performance, basically the brand marketers are looking up at the end goal only. If you are able to actually define that, then I think the game changes or you are able to shift it. Because the point is that people are looking at the end goal rather than actually looking at the overall funnel. When they start looking at it, doesn't matter. That's where the challenge is.
And the end goal is defined as what?
It can be varied. So for example, for an FMCG player, it might be, for example, in the end, how is it actually moving their business?
No, so my struggle is invariably the end goal ends up being defined as sale. Now I'd like to know whatever happened to good old marketing and brand equity. Why is that digital media is limited to being a sales media and therefore eventually has to show conversion in sale and TV and print is not? And where 90% of money is going.
Gautam, why don't you react to it as well?
You know, that's the nature of the beast, that whole digital media is about performance. At the end of it, you know, niche publishers or even large publishers can say, you know, branding. But I've been about 10 years in the industry or more. But I've seen fundamentally it's about performance. So we've got to adapt and figure out what solutions we can also sort of bring to the mix, which leads the user down the conversion funnel, which...
Yeah, no, so I disagree with that.
I mean, there is some money that is there for pure display or pure branding, but it's far and few. If your revenue aspirations are high in hundreds of crores of rupees, then that approach doesn't work. That is where I'm coming from.
So I spent 25 years of my life working as a head of marketing at several multinational companies. Again, I should not bother to name them. We had a ongoing debate where a sales guy would come and say, tell my CEO, stop wasting money on advertising, give me that money, I'll turn it into discount and guarantee you the sales delivery. And he was right, he could have done that. But the CEO, the smart guy that he was, said, no, I can't do that because if you do that for 3, 4, 5 quarters consistently, eventually my brand equity will be dead. I need to continue to invest in building the brand and equity. Where is that money when it comes to the digital world is my simple question.
we are all looking for it. As in, yeah. I think basically.
I was just going to say that, yeah, we are all looking for it.
We have the same page and same thing where we are trying to actually drive home the same thing to the marketers that digital is not only a performance medium, yes it is, but I think we should be looking at a brand building or for any traditional media, what traditional media can do, digital can do it better with a layer of performance or a conversion thing as well. So I think we are driving that, we are striving for it, and that's where
so we yeah. Right. So I think it's important to establish a direction to this conversation as well, that it's not just about specialized audiences. Okay. There are other factors interplaying. So for example, data insights, of course, has become very big. While we can harp around the fact that we have curated sets of audiences that is ready on the table for you, unlike you going to large scale publishers and getting sliced and diced data, which could be stumbled upon data and not intended consumers like we have. While we are addressing that, I think premium pay, or rather the command for premium pay comes out of the other two important factors. One is data, which is again insights and engagement, how engaged your audience is. And of course, format also plays a very important role, whether it's inventory, whether it's placement, or whether it's content. So what we are trying to do as an organization, and so I represent Worldwide Media, and we own brands like, we are 100% Times Group subsidiary, and we own brands like Femina and Filmfare. We've run them for the longest time, and we have international licenses right. of Lonely Planet, Top Gear, Hello, Grazia. So the way we are doing it is we have a triangular matrix that we follow, where audience, format, and data, between the three of them, there are three quadrants, and there's multiple latitudes and longitudes running between them, which is defining very, very hardcore fragmentation. And this fragmentation is very, very dynamic, because it's constantly changing, right? So there's a tendency of marketers, media agencies, and publishers all getting sucked and lost in this entire transition of this or entire dynamics of this triangle. It's important to map these three aspects to the consumer decision journey. So we are talking about specialized audiences, which is the starting point, and performance, which is probably the final point. In between, there's a lot of value that publishers like us bring on the table, right? So we partner with marketers or media agencies, and we try and understand at what part of the funnel do they want us to kind of create value. Is it at the awareness level? Is it at the interest level, or is it at the desire level? Because these are the three levels where we provide a lot of value. We create compelling content which evokes a lot of high level of interest. And then we subtly, but very seamlessly and organically, marry in advertiser propositions, whether it's, it's functionality of a product or the aspirational value of a brand or simple affordability of price. So while we get bulk of this funnel right, the now objective is to actually get performance right. And we're building digital outfits, which is actually answering that question as well. So if you convince advertisers and media agencies that we are absolutely bang on the bulk of that funnel, I think performance is something which anyway, I mean, we are taking help of media
so
agencies.
So I have one, yeah. Sorry. I agree to everything you said, but I have take one objection to what Gopa and you have said, which is limiting performance equals sales. Performance equals brand equity is just as important. And that's the only reason we are all in this room, because if it was about sales, then marketers would not exist. So why is performance equal to just sales
and not equal to brand equity building?
So where are those metrics that we can use as publishers? I'm asking Gopa this question. As an agency, what metrics are you going to propagate or ask me to deliver on which are linked to brand equity? Favorite brand? Top of mind awareness, you put your numbers, you put your metrics, we will deliver on those. But if performance equals sales, then I think it's a very, very limited perspective.
Maybe I stand corrected. I didn't mention that performance equals sales. Performance equals any kind of an end objective that needs to be kind of delivered, right? So it could be at any level. It could just be awareness.
But correct, it's the same thing. Yeah, again, I'm not saying performance is equal to sales. Performance is equal to whatever metric that we may agree before undertaking a campaign or, for example, a brand metric. So it can be, let's say, top of mind recall, a brand lift, pre or post, basically whatever that we agree on before or with the publisher at the end of the
but
day.
But how many campaigns have you recently released where you put those metrics as benchmarks?
Most of them.
Maybe I'm dealing with the wrong agencies. I have yet to see a campaign that had brand metrics as a deliverable. The only deliverables I got, uniques, CTR and conversion, and now the newfangled language of viewability.
I think the conversation has moved there. I'm again saying that where brands are now, and most of our clients where we do interact, we have started moving, while viewability is a big concern, click fraud and other things where the questions are coming in. But the second question which is actually moving is apart from conversion, where, for example, we have a car brand, clearly, we're not looking at end sales. We are looking at in terms of how we are able to actually change the brand lift overall. And these are the conversations that we are having with the CMOs and CDOs as well. And I'm hoping that that shift will happen. And
That's really good to hear.
Yeah, why don't you join the conversation? You know, Vikas has mentioned brand equity so many times. So I'll ask you a question. What threatens the equity of a specialized site today, especially with programmatic ads can follow me around everywhere on the web as I navigate? They can catch me on any site. They can catch me on Facebook. So what to you is the biggest threat to a specialized site when it comes to the equity?
We've embraced all sorts of ad formats and all sort of technologies. That's the way we are going ahead with it. I think that is not a threat to us. It's an enabler for us. Because any technology development is an enabler. Either you adapt it or embrace it or just sort of be left out. So programmatic is sort of a core strategy for us. So fundamentally, with regards to, let's say, money control, there is programmatic sales, there is direct sales, and there is branded content sales. That's fundamentally the way we are going about it. And most niche publishers, publishers would sort of follow that strategy.
One of the things we are all seeing is that advertisers are moving from banner ads, which is what they would do if they try and catch you somewhere else, more to content. So they have realized that just because I can programmatically follow you, or I can use various services of people like Vizuri, others, to plant an ad on the website you're on based on what you saw somewhere else, that works to an extent, but ultimately, if I can put the same thing in content, and when the consumer consumes the content, it works a lot harder. So I think it's not really a threat, because content will still be king.
That brings to the question again in terms of what do you constitute as premium, because as I said, if you're actually moving and the world is moving programmatic, you can actually figure out audiences, or you can reach out to audiences through various means. So if you end, it's important for publishers who are actually looking at, or these niche sites who are looking at audiences to define premium. And why would an audience would be coming there and spending time and doing multi-level activities? And why should a marketer pay premium to that particular site while they can reach out to those kind of audiences programmatically as well? So that's a challenge. And that's where the discussion should be. That's what my belief is.
So any guidance for publishers such as ourselves as the agency who is the middleman between the client and us, what should we be coming and pitching to you which would make you think of us in your media planning?
Well, what I think is, I'm sort of jumping in a way, what I think is as publishers, we need to market ourselves, you know, really heavily. Market our audiences, market our USP in that sense. I don't think a lot of us do that job very well. And that is also a fact that we don't get, you know, mind space with the agencies. Because let's face it, Google, Facebook get 90% of the mind share. That leaves very little time for people like us to go and build a case study with agencies, with advertisers, with CMOs. So that is a vicious circle that one is caught into. If you're not able to go to an advertiser or a CMO or an agency here and give your story, you know, in a very, very, you know, engaging way and tell them, listen, I am what I am because I have audiences and these are premium audiences and this is India's 1% of stock trading audiences in my case, you know, we got to have that opportunity. Which, because now digital has, 1,000 vendors, 1,000 publishers, it becomes difficult. At the agency side, they will just sort of deal with 4 or 5 top guys, you know, Google, Facebook, and a few other guys, and then the rest ones are just sort of, you know, left twiddling their thumbs.
And again, the challenge again is that we end up going the numbers game in terms of we have these many users, these many views. The idea, for example, if you are a niche site, I think you should be, again, as you rightly said, harbor on content and terms time spent, and then look at various bad brand metrics and how brands who have been part of the platform has delivered to those metrics. I think that will be a good case in point for us to start moving more and more money.
I think picking up from what Gautam was mentioning, I think publishers also need to understand that they are also brands. Mm. They need to be extremely obsessed about their consumers. Right now, I think what we are obsessing about is how my consumers are interacting with the advertising proposition. And we are kind of not spending enough time on how the consumers are interacting with us. So I think any other brand or a product seller, so let's just take an example of Amazon. Tomorrow, and of course they are into the ad business as well, tomorrow if they launch a massive outfit of going out and selling advertising solutions to to various marketers, I think the amount of data that they have, both behaviorally and transactional data, none of the publishers will be able to kind of match that. So it's important for us also to deep dive so much into data insights and engagement to understand that when we are going and talking to marketers and media agencies, it's not just about saying that, this is the profile of my audience or this is the persona of my audience, but this is what the number of times they're interacting with us and what are the various touch points where we can catch them. So I think that's very important.
We do have a panel on brand building specifically for
absolutely.
Publishers. Yeah. Is that something that preoccupies you for your clients, building their brands for online publishing?
True. Again, I'm completely agreeing with the fact that I think that's where things are moving again. And rightly, Amazon is a case in point. It's coming, it's reality. They are actually have advertising as an overall strategy which has been built in, and they've started doing that as well. More and more increasingly internationally as well as in India, you start seeing brand marketing, marketing spends moving there because obviously huge data, they know what the customers are, what they're doing, and obviously you can actually end.
So I have a question for Gopa on that front. So I agree with you on the engagement front, right? So I'm going to name my brand, Digit, which is my media brand. We engage with more people when it comes to tech content on Facebook than any other media content brand in the world. So more people engage with Digit content than CNET, than Wired, than Verge. Forget about the Indian sites. They are nowhere close to us, right? But whenever we have talked about that, somehow that engagement is considered less valuable than people coming on site and number of pages that they're seeing, right? Now, I just want to get a sense from Gopa, given that he deals with both publishers as well as advertisers. Why is there this bias? Because if social media is as important as it is and people are spending so much time engaging in my content, and you know that Facebook only defines engagement when someone likes, comments, or shares, that means it's an active engagement, not just viewing. Why is not that not given importance?
It should be given importance, again, as I said. Yeah. And I think the importance should be given. If it is not being given, I think the conversation is not happening in the right way. Clearly, we again, as we see, for example, if the engagement is happening, the time spent is huge. I think I will put more value there rather than actually numbers, because numbers can be anything, right? So for me, engagement comes if the ultimate goal is that. I think the engagement will come upfront rather than actually any other number. So as an agency or as a brand, where we interact and when we speak to our clients as well, engagement is the number one criteria. So I think that conversation should be there.
So I think this is one challenge that typically we are also facing. So I completely agree with you that such kind of an engagement solution is not looked at from a premium point of view, because probably somewhere down the line, media agencies are now benchmarking their bulk buying rates. So if you go and ask for a premium saying, my social audience engagement is of an X amount, they will come back with a Y amount saying, main to itna inventory aise hi khareed leta hu yaar, mujhe to aise hi mil jati hai. So against your 200 rupees, I buy it at 60 rupees. So that's a classic challenge. They need to understand that, organically we are engaging them. Secondly, it's not, it's a very, very curated piece of content that we are creating, and hence the premiumness of that needs to be considered.
Gautam, why don't you respond to that as well? It's a good question. And also answer this, that, what's the one piece of advice you would give a specialized site? Because what I see is they start out covering one thing, right? So say nail art, okay? And then in a bid to scale quickly, they start covering things that they didn't intend to cover originally. So patience is something they don't have. So would you say that's the biggest piece of advice you might give a specialized site? It's a lot of soul selling almost, before you know it, there's yoga, there's nail art, there's hair. And you're a wholesome goodness website. You're not so specialized anymore.
I don't know about the advice part, but I think we are just sticking to basics. That here's an audience that comes to us. What is the purpose of the audience? Let's sort of give him a great experience, great offering, and try to engage him more and more. Fortunately for us, the engagement pays off because there's some ad revenue that comes in. But the aspiration is obviously to sort of do that more in a much bigger way. So I think there's no advice as such, but just sort of do what you do best, you know.
Okay, so stick to what you originally intended,
Sorry, so sometimes being cross-genre also works, and this is an example that I want to quote, it's a funny thing. We were selling advertising solutions to a tissue paper brand, and they wanted some kind of a targeting, so they were trying to analyze, you know, who's the feminine audience, and we had to sell, right? So we said, you know, audiences that come on the beauty, tissue paper is used by everybody for that matter. They wanted to target women. So we said, as sexist as it sounds, people who come onto the beauty section, obviously because they tend to put makeup and after that they want to use a tissue paper to wipe that off their face. People who come onto the cooking section because after they cook, people eat, they'll use tissue paper. So this is how we are actually selling targeted audience. I mean, so as you were saying, you know, sometimes it also takes a funny shape, but sometimes cross-genre works, and you know, I thought I'll share that example.
Yeah, no, great. Gopa, where are you on this soul selling? You know, do specialized sites in the broadest sense lack patience?
Yes, so I think the focus would be to keep at it in terms of what you specialize in. I think if you start to branch out too much, you end up losing for what you start for, basically. Again, case in point, let's say an LBB. It's a niche site, and we know why the audience is coming there, and advertiser also knows. If they start branching out to something else, obviously it doesn't actually become a niche site, right? So that's where the thing is. If you focus on what you are supposed to be, what you started off, I think that would be great. Yes, if you want to branch out later on, maybe after, patience is the game, clearly. But the point is that if you focus there, I think you'll reap more benefits rather than actually.
Just imagine National Geographic showing FTV content. Doesn't work. I think it's true for any brand, right? You got to know what you stand for, what your positioning, and stick to it.
Great, great. Where are we on time? Great. Yeah, let's quickly jump into the Q&A round. If there are any questions for our panelists?
Everybody's very hungry, and so am I.
Yeah, no, we have someone there.
It's a slightly long question. During sometime around 2012, there were about 15,000 brands advertising on the radio and television, and around 150,000, maybe 100,000 plus brands advertising, including print. Now, what the newer technologies did was that even if you have a small campaign, say $5, you know, you're a specialized audience, you could reach to, you could set a campaign. The newer technologies from Facebook or Google campaign, whatever you could say. Is there, and I was watching this discussion, is there something which you could do on the demand side of the equation where you could curate users directly without the agencies or something to pull those users more directly to your kind of property, something being done from your side?
At least I'm not sure I get the question. So can you give an example?
Yeah, maybe the newer technologies like Google, Facebook, you could set a campaign at a small value, find out the relevant users, and you know, you can deliver that campaign. Maybe there are a lot of possibilities where users want to advertise to you, and from the demand side, maybe you could directly reach out to them. Is there some tools kind like that available in general, apart from Google and Facebook, where they could do it for your properties?
I don't know. I mean, if you're saying, can I advertise to a highly specialized target audience, which may be very small in numbers, and will I be able to entertain an advertiser like that? The answer is yes and yes. But as long as the definition of that specialized audience is linked to what I do, so if I'm a gadget site and if you give me specifications based on I'm looking at people who own such devices, da-da-da, living here, doing that, yeah, I can target those people. I can curate those people and target them. But if it gets into some other psychographic definition which is not linked to the content of my site, then I have the same disability as any other mass media.
Okay. Do we have any other questions?
Was that your question? I'm not sure.
About generating demand, that was his question. Any more questions? Yeah, there's one. We can take that one.
Yeah, hi. So I don't know if this is a question or thinking out loud, but Vikas, thanks for venting out that, you know, frustration. As a publisher myself, I can relate to it. Now, I run a tech site which is around, I think, half the size of Digit. So I have kind of, you know, been there and, you know, spoken to advertisers and everything. And I know how it works. And, you know, I mean, when Gopa, when you say that, you know, things like engagement and all, I mean, needle is moving and they are being considered. Now, I myself, I'm not able to see that. Like, we make great content and, you know, the engagement, like, I have a YouTube channel which has around 500,000 subscribers and, you know, we make really good content. But when we go to the advertisers, the conversation starts there, but eventually, you know, it kind of comes down to ki kitne views milenge, you know, what are the page views on your articles, whatever. So that is still there. And I think part of the reason which, because you mentioned that, you know, this is a mindset which will take time to change. They are with that mindset and, you know, it's, even when we try to convince them, they are not able to, you know, think from the brand metric perspective. But I think I would also like to put the ball in our courts and think over this. And, you know, why an advertiser when, you know, same advertisers, when they go to an AIB or a TVF, they are willing to pay top dollar for the same 1 million views. And why when a Digit or Guiding Tech in my case, when we deliver the same 1 million views, they're not willing to pay that top dollar. So somewhere I think maybe, I don't know, maybe we need to work on the brand element a little more. That's one thing. And when it comes to scaling, Ashwini, I take issue with the soul selling part of the argument. I don't think it's that because, again, if someone is doing nail art, if yoga or lifestyle things relate to that, so that publisher should scale because, again, it comes down to advertisers want numbers. And if they don't have scale, then it becomes really difficult to survive as a business. So, I mean, yeah, that was it, actually.
Is there a Thank question you. Somewhere?
Well, I mean, the question mainly was with respect to the brand thing as to what we could do probably on the brand front.
I do want to clarify, I'm not propagating not getting measured. I'm very happy to get measured. I'm very happy I'm getting measured, and I want those metrics. So I don't want my little rant to be taken away as I'm not happy getting measured. I just wish measurement could be applied to the other media houses as well. That's all.